So yesterday what we did, we reached to the completion of AP setups, and what we discuss is like we will see a transaction flow, not a transaction flow. We'll make sure that invoices and payments are working fine. So we have done up to this one. We did the all the GL setup. We have done the invoice setup. So now what we have to do is we will check one invoice and payment. We'll do create accounting and stuff and make sure like this module is fine. Then we'll shift to the setup for inventory. Okay, so I was just opening the periods. Actually, I have already created one invoice and payment. And I was trying to create the accounting entries, and then I realized that accounting periods are not open. So I'm just opening the accounting periods to see. We need to open one more month, July.
I think you can open directly the target period. No? That way, I think it will open for.
Yeah, but just want to be safer side. Because we'll do the transaction for some when we are doing the transaction, we'll try to do multiple activities. We'll see the closing procedure also. So from month to month, how is it moving? And then reconciliation also, if time permits, we'll see reconciliation process also. So we're just trying to go with the sequence. Okay, so we finished this AP setups, and then we said yesterday like we'll create one invoice and one payment, and make the create account, do the create accounting entry and transfer to GL. So for that process, what I have done, first thing we need to open the accounting period. Accounting period also I have opened. So for opening the accounting period, navigation is simple. We just go here in AP module and then accounting, and here we have the control accounting period. So all these sub ledger like payables, inventory, purchasing, all these modules we have to open the accounting period within the sub ledger, within the module as well. Okay, so in the GL we need to open the accounting period, and in the sub ledger we need to open the accounting period. So then we just give here the ledger name and operating unit name, click find, and any period we need to open, just click on that period and change the value to open and save it. So up to August I have already opened. And opening the GL period we know already. So we open the accounting period in GL and we open the accounting period in AP module. Now the next thing is to create an invoice and the payment. So just go to invoice. So I just create a simple invoice with no more details, a very simple one. And also I've created a supplier. For creating the invoice, we need the supplier. So I've created a simple invoice with 5,000. Invoice line. When we do the transaction, we'll see all these details because it will be repetition otherwise. So I'm just showing you like one invoice is created and distribution account I've given here. And then once we create the invoice, the next step is to do the action. We have to validate the invoice and we need to do the credit accounting for the invoice. So these two steps I have done already. Invoice is validated and invoice is credit accounting is done. So if we see the status here, invoice status is validated and accounted is yes, which means already accounting entry is created. Okay, I have also made the payment for this. And this is the payment number. Right, so this is the payment number. So if you want to see the payment, view payment. The status of the payment is accounting is not done. Okay, so what we can do is we can find this payment. And make the create accounting. So in create accounting, we have the option for draft, final, and post. So draft is, it will only give you a draft and show what is debit and credit accounting entry is going to create. You can see it in the output. If we say final, final means accounting entry will be created and it will be stored in AP module and SLM module itself. It will not go to general ledger. So we need to separately run the transfer to GL program to transfer these entries to the general ledger. Final and post means we finally create this accounting entry and post it in the general ledger. All the steps, create the accounting entry, send it to SLA and send it to GL, and then even in GL post this entry. Okay, let's click OK. Accounting entry has been successfully created. Now if you see, it will run the program. Now it is doing the create accounting. And the general import is running. So in the older versions like 11i and stuff, these were the separate step. Create accounting was a different program. Transfer to general ledger was a different program. So in R12, it is when you run this one program, it will run all the connected programs. So general import will transfer the JVs from the sub ledger module to your general ledger module. It's importing basically from the GL interface table, it is importing these records. Now this program is posting that entry. Now it reached to the general ledger and it is posting it in the general ledger. Okay, this is done. So now what we have done, we have now the status of the payment changed to be processed. Fine. Now so we create one invoice and we create one payment and we create the accounting entries and let's confirm it from general ledger. We can give the filter like date created. So we created today's date. Now here you see payable. This entry came for the invoice, and this entry came for the payment. Okay. Now just check this one. Fine. So this is debit and credit. So now we have seen that we made the transactions for the invoice and payment. We create the accounting in the AP, and then the accounting entries came up with the general ledger, which means the AP module is fine. So the transaction process we'll see all with the transaction cycle, because as we said earlier, all the transactions are connected. So when we go in the transaction flow, we'll see right from the purchasing to inventory and to VAP and all the transactions we'll see all together. So invoice AP has got a lot of transactions, like it has invoice, standard invoice, credit memos, debit memos, prepayments, prepayment applications, and payments, wiring of the payment, all the reversal process as well. If you make an invoice and the payment, then the cancellation process also is there. So we'll have two processes. One is the flow from A to Z, and then the reversal process from Z to A. Okay, so that will do. So now with this one, what we'll do, we'll stop for the AP and we'll move to inventory module. Now in inventory, there are certain concepts we'll discuss, and then we'll go into these screens. So what are the things we have? Now inventory. What is inventory? Inventory is nothing but the materials. So your material management, they call the module as the inventory module, where we are taking care of the you know, all the materials which is required in the company, right? Now there are few concepts we'll discuss before we get into the main the forms and the screens and the stuff. So now how about the inventory? How many type of materials we can have? How many type of material we can consider? So one is the inventory, or we can say stockable items. Stockable items is something which we buy, which we stock, and then we issued for consumption. Okay, so stockable items buy, store, and consume. These three things will happen with the stockable items. Fine. What is the stockable item? Then this is basically this is the main inventory. This is the main inventory value. Then what we have is the next non-stockable items. Non-stackable items is like we buy and consume. We don't store them. Okay, non-stackable is like something you needed at the time of working, so you simply bought it and you consume it itself. There, it's not going to the it's not going to the inventory module, right? So all your services also will be not non-stockable, because we buy the services and we consume the services. We are not going to stock it anywhere, nothing. Okay, so we'll have the stockable items, we'll have the non-stockable items. Either items, another item will be assets. So assets are like we buy them and we identify it as assets. Then we'll capitalize. Then we'll depreciate, and then we retire. Okay. So a few items might be more. So asset items are not also not coming to your inventory module. When we buy the items, it goes to asset module, and we add them into the asset book. So in the asset book, we'll track them. What is the value of this asset? How much to depreciate? When to retire? And when to increase the value? Appreciate the value? Depreciate the value? All the asset related activities we'll be doing in the asset module. So when we are buying these items, so basically when we are defining the items, we have to see the parameters of these items. Is it going to be purchasable? Is stockable? Is going to be a non-stockable? Or is going to be an asset item that will decide at the time of? So when we go to discuss the inventory, so item master is one of the thing which we discuss with the customer. Okay, what type of items you have got and what is the nature of these items. Okay, so these are the few categories we'll get. So one will be your asset items. The another one will be non-costable items. Non-costable items, which mean it is not our inventory. Okay, we get these stocks, we store these stocks, we need to track this stock, but we are not, it not belongs to us. Okay, so what we can say is we don't buy it, but we stock and track quantity. Okay. We do not consider the value in inventory. Example of this, these items, like for example, if we are doing manufacturing and they will have the customers for the manufacturing also. Like for example, we are doing all manufacturing. So, or say plaster manufacturing. What is plaster? Plaster is like the white cement. In India, it's very popular. POP we call plaster of Paris. So this plaster, we do manufacture for ourselves. So it will go with our packing and stuff. Now there will be other companies who will come and to our manufacturing unit, and they say like, okay, you do manufacturing for our plaster as well, and you do the packing in our packing bags. Okay, so plaster is plaster. It's my plaster or other company plaster is a plaster only. Right. So sometimes what happens, like companies, if the international companies, if they got an order and they need to deliver it within India, so what they do, they will try to contact some local manufacturer, and they will say, you do manufacturing for us, and the packing you do, you pack it in our our bags. And then when they are, it's a drop shipment concept. So that when they are dropping, when they are sending the material to the, their customers, they will pick it from the manufacturing unit and they shift it to the customer. Okay. So in this scenario, the customer will send the bags, the packing, all the the bags for the plasters. So now these bags we need to store in our inventory, because we need to track the quantity, how much we received, how much we packed, and how much we said, how much is damaged and all, because it's also a value for the customer. But it's not part of our stock, so we cannot show the value in our inventory. Okay, so this type of item we only need to say stockable, but it is not costed. So not costed means anything we do with this item, we issue from the warehouse, or we receive into the warehouse, or we do anything, any adjustment or stuff, system will not create the accounting entry for these items. Okay, this is one of the example. Non-stockable items and non-costable items. So this is few things about the inventory item. Now, inventory categorizations will be there. What is inventory category? Inventory category is nothing but we are grouping the inventory with the nature of material. So this is for reporting purpose, right? For example, electricals, we give a grouping like category as electricals, and within electricals we can say multimedia. So this category we can assign to the items which are related to the electrical and multimedia, like TV and your you know, all your sound equipments, what do you call that, speakers, and your what else we have, projectors and screens and this kind of stuff. All this type of material we can categorize into electrical, multimedia. Then another will be electrical and say wires or cables. Okay. Now within the cables, you may have lot of cables for a lot of purposes. Small cable, big cable, this cable, that cable, all the cables. All the kind of cables which are used in the construction and in the building equipment or maintenance or anything, we can group them, all of them, into the cables one. Okay, then we can have something like IT, and we can have hardware. Then IT hardware, we can add all the servers, laptops, desktops, etc. So what is the purpose of categorization? It will help you, like in this category, how is the expense going on? In this category, how is the consumption going on? So all the inventory kind of reports, it will be helpful if you have a category assigned to the inventory item. Okay. So one is the inventory, and one is the, one item type we have discussed, and we have discussed the categorization. So apart from the categorization, another important factor on the item master is the unit of measure. Okay, what is unit of measure? Very simply, how we are, you know, calculating or how we are managing this product. Like for example, if it is physical quantities, like if you talk about laptops, we'll count them. So we'll say each. Okay, each means it's a kind of how we are calculating it, how we are keeping the stock of this particular item. And then we have, say for example, oil is there. So oil, we cannot say each. What is the unit of measure for oil? How we are measuring this oil? So oil will be in liters, right? So what is unit of measure? Unit of measure is nothing but how we are measuring this quantity. If we have cable, right? So for cable, we cannot say kg or inch or liters, we cannot say, right? So what will be the possible, you know, the unit of measure for cables? It can be meters. Okay, so this is the unit of measure. Now the very important concept about the unit of measure is the conversion. We call it UOM conversion. So what is the unit of measure conversion? Unit of measure conversion is nothing but converting the unit of measure into another unit of measure. Okay. For example, we have the for the conversion purpose, we have unit of measure classes. And within the class, we'll group all the similar, similar unit of measures. For example, if I say here weight, I will take all the weight related unit of measures within this class. For example, kilogram and milligram. What else we have? Same way, if we have a class for volume, the liters, milliliters, like this. Okay, so class, what we do basically, class will do we create the class, and within the class we create the unit of measure. So within this class, how we define this unit of measures, the related unit of measure only we can define in the similar class. Let me see if you can see it on the screen. Unit of measure. So we have here three things. One is the unit of measure classes, unit of measure conversion. So if you go to the unit of measure classes, for example, I'll take M1. So here you can see there's a lot of classes are defined. This one is area. If we go into the unit of measures of this class, so we have square feet, we have square inch, we have square meter, right? If we go to count, then we have box, we have bottle, we have can, we have pack, we have dozen, we have each, right? So like dozen and each, these are countable things. Now the other one, we can have box of 10, box of 50, box of 30, box of 80, right? Like that, we can have different unit of measure. So if I go here, if I say box of 10, and here I can write B10, is the code for this. And here we can mention box of 10. Same way, I can have a box of 20, and we can say B20, and it is box of 20. Now, every class, like this count is a class, every class will have one unit of measure as the base unit of measure. What is the purpose of this base unit of measure? The base unit of measure will help you to convert, to drive the conversion between the another unit of measure. There will be scenarios like you can buy in a box of 20, and while receiving, you can receive it, each, or you can receive box of 10. So you can receive two box of 10. So if you order something like box of 100, so instead of giving you box of 100, supplier might have sent you 10 boxes of box of 10. Okay, so that all possible. So then the system will allow you to make this entries if there is a conversion defined between these two unit of measures. Okay, if I say box of 100, here you cannot write, is already there. Okay, so for the conversion point of view, so this is the unit of measure we defined in the class. Now if you close this, and if you see the conversion, here you see the conversion you will write in the base unit of measure. I will take box of 100, box of 10, and it is equal to 100 each. So here it defaults you the your base unit of measure of this count, you know, the count class. So in the count class, box of 10 equal to how much? So box of 10, I will say 10 each, right? So you are writing the conversion in the base unit of measure. The same way, if I say box of 20, box of 20, then I'll say how many, if I'm giving a box of 20, how many each will be there in this box of 20? So I'll say it will be 20, 20 each. Okay, just save it. Because we have defined the conversion between this each and the box, and box of 10 and 20. So when we are doing the transaction, system will allow you to play around with this one. When you make an order, you can make box of 20 as an order, two box of one box of 20. When you're receiving, you can receive two box of 10. Okay, and system will automatically convert these two with the base unit of measure. Okay, so what we have in the unit of measure area, we have class UIM and then conversion. Class and unit of measures and the conversion. So there are a lot more things we'll see with the transactions also. So these are some of the concepts and unit of measures, rules, organization, the same parameter. Okay, with this one we'll have the control items. So now brief, we discussed inventory structure in our initial classes also. So just to recap, we'll again discuss the inventory structure. And with this inventory structure, we have few more critical items to discuss. So what is a warehouse or inventory org? Okay, so inventory org, it will be a physical or it can be a virtual based on the need, based on the required situation. 80% of the time or 90% of the time it will be a physical inventory only. Sometimes we need to create the virtual inventory where inventory does not exist, but to control or to manage the processes, we may require to create an inventory of which is physically not available. Okay, I'll give you some examples. So just talk about first one, this physical one. So physical one, what is a warehouse? So warehouse is nothing but a physical warehouse of your company where we stock the material. Whatever we buy, we stock the materials here. So now these warehouses will be different based on the different companies. For service industries, it will be very minimum because service people, they hardly use the stationary item or they may use the maintenance material. So that is the only inventory for them. And 99% of the time, they don't do costing. They only, first of all, they will not store that much. And if they store also, they will not take into account for the costing part. Okay, they will only track the quantity, fine. But the inventories are like more important in the manufacturing industry and the retail industry. So for them, inventory has to be a properly controlled thing. Okay, so now there is two parameters with the inventory. One is the quantity tracking, and one is the cost tracking. Okay, so when we talk about the inventory warehouse, the importance of this inventory warehouse, when I say some material is there, So if I ask like what is my inventory value, so I am asking about the quantity multiplied by cost. Okay, so that becomes my inventory value. Quantity multiplied by cost. Now the cost portion is very interesting. We'll discuss in detail about the cost. So first come to the quantity tracking part. Now for tracking the quantity, what is the meaning of tracking quantity? We need to know how much we have. We need to know where it is. Now, why the question is so difficult? Why we don't know how much we have and why we don't know where it is, right? Now, for the small companies, everything can be visible. You can see the stock, you can see the material, but consider the implementations for the ERPs is mainly for the large scale companies. So large scale companies, the warehouses will be very big, very big. Some example is like we did one airlines project, and the warehouse is like something around 3 kilometers. So if you enter into the warehouse, then you need to take a bike to go inside and see the warehouse how it is. So if somebody come to the counter and ask for some spare parts or something, then you need to check in the system and you will see which location it is. Then you will go by. There will be electrical car inside the warehouse. Or they can use the bikes inside the warehouse to go and collect this material, and they will come back to the window in half an hour or 1 hour time. Okay, so it will be that much big, material things will be there. We did one project for the oil manufacturing. The raw material stock and it was so big, like from one location to another, within the warehouse, from one location to another location, the material transferred via trains. So they have the train tracks within the factory, and from one location to another location, material will be going in train tracks. So that huge it is. So that's why tracking the quantity where my stuff is there, and once it comes in, where it is lying and from where to bring in, and if you lost the visibility, if you are unable to track it, then it will be a huge loss for the company, right? So for that purpose, tracking is very important. Now, when we say that tracking is very important, what Oracle is, how Oracle is supporting for this tracking? What are the various components or various factors we get to get, to track this material? So now this is one box. So this we can consider as one warehouse location. So now we can fix it. Now when we are designing the structure, we have organization. Inside the organization, we have sub inventory. Inside the sub inventory, we have rows. Inside the rows, we have racks. Inside the racks, we have bins. Okay, so these are the five parameters where we can go up to the stock where it is exactly placed. Based on that, we can go and collect this material. Okay, so as we discussed earlier, so inventory organization is nothing but your location or your organization or the building, the physical building, or the area where you might be having, like, say, now when we consider this as an inventory organization, the scenario may happen like within one location you may have 4 or 5 buildings. So now it is a choice of the company or the behavior of the system. We have to decide these five buildings in the location should be considered as five different inventory organization, or should we consider one inventory organization? Okay, so that time we have to justify and we have to judge what is the better opinion and how the currently how the company is doing that one. How we can identify, one of the ways to find out how is the control. If there is a different departments controlling these different organizations, then we may recommend them to go with a different inventory organization. And if the costing, the valuation of this inventory is controlled differently by these different locations, then we can say, okay, each building we can define as a different inventory organization. But let's say there is only one department sitting in one building and they are controlling all the four buildings and the fifth building as well, and they are controlling the cost and the quantity, everything, all the stuff reporting there itself. So then they will say, no, this is one inventory for us. It's not a different inventory for us. Okay. So that way, like based on such type of discussions, we can decide how the inventory structure should look like. And there is no hard and fast rule. These are the options we have. And then how feasible it is for the companies to use, and it should not disturb your costing and accounting behavior, and it should not make the life difficult for the end user. So keeping those parameters in mind, we have to design this structure. Okay, so let's consider one simple structure. So this is one inventory organization. Now within one inventory organization, we can have different rooms. Okay, we can have the different rooms. These different rooms we called as a sub inventory, right? Now coming back to our previous example, if there is five buildings, I can consider one building as an inventory organization, the another buildings or one, all this location as one organization, and each of the building I can consider as one sub inventory. Okay, so as I said, there is no hard and fast rule. Based on the flexibility, based on the the current structure of the warehouse, how they are using it, we have to decide that way. Okay, so under the inventory organization, we'll have the sub inventory. So one sub inventory can be specific to a one type of material or a group of type of materials we are stocking here. Okay, sometimes the materials are sensitive. So we cannot keep two materials beside one another for the security reason and this stuff. Like if you have something which is fire sensitive, so we cannot keep it near the heaters or this stuff. If there is something like poison sensitive, so we cannot keep it near the if the hazard chemicals, we cannot keep it near the food materials and this stuff. So if some mistake happens, so it will be a risk for the situation. And there will be specific rooms given for the chemicals and the hazard materials. So they need to maintain a separate locked room, and it has to be controlled by access people and all. So that way we'll have a different room for different reasons. We can, there will be a different areas or different rooms will be there for storing this material. Now it is not mandatory to have a physical room with a lock and a key. It can be a physical room, or it can be just a partition between this material and this material, or it can be an open space, one in this this side and another one is in another side, or it can be just locked with the wires and cables just to identify a different location. So that is how the sub inventories look like. So within these sub inventories we'll have the rows, racks and bins. So what is this rows? Rows is nothing but each rack row. I was trying to get some images. Like this is one image I got. Like this is one warehouse, right? Within this one warehouse, you can see here we have one different storage here. And here we have a different storage, and here we have a different storage. it's not a physical room, but there is a partitions which is dividing these stocks. Okay, so these divisions we can consider as the sub inventories, right? Then another one, what is a row? Row is each of this line. If you see this yellow line, this each line is one row, right? And then what is a rack? So within this one line, it's we cannot have a rack, you know, start to end, right? Rack may be like 1 meter or 3 meters or 2 meters like that. We'll have a size for the rack. Rack cannot be 1 kilometer, right? So in one row, we can have say 5 racks or 10 racks or 15 racks within the row, right? So now with that racks, then we'll have inside the racks, we'll have the bins. I have one more image for. This is like the bins. So this is one rack. Okay, inside one rack, these are the bins. Fine, you got it. I think it's visible, right? So this is the these are the bins. So each bin has got the required material into this one. So and these are the maintenance areas. This there will be a room and there will be a window where people come and ask for the material. So from there. Material, when you see the item code and you enter the item code in the system, then system will give you the location in which sub inventory it is, in which row it is placed, and what is the rack number of this, and inside that rack in which bin number this material is placed. So the helper, the storekeeper, he will directly go straight, he will come here, he'll pick the material and he will go to the window to issue the material. Okay, so that is the purpose, to help the team inside here to find out what things place where, to go there and pick it and bring it to the requester. Okay, so that is the concept of your inventory organization, sub inventory, row, racks and bins. Fine, so this is about the physical tracking. Fine. In physical tracking, another concept we get here is the batch. And lot. Serial number. Yeah, these are the things. And there is LPN also is there. License plate number. LPN is used with the warehouse management system, so just to keep it to our memory. So batch, lot and the serial number. So what is batch and lot and the serial number? Mostly it is interchangeable components. People mostly use the batch and the lot as the same, but we can consider it in a different way. So let's say, for example, manufacturing, what happens? Manufacturing, what will happen? They will create batches in the manufacturing. In process manufacturing, they say batch. So in the batch, what they will say, okay, in a batch, I need 1,000 bags. They will create a batch of 1,000 1,000 plaster bags, okay? Now 1,000 plaster bag, when they create the batch, so this batch will ask for the required raw materials. So the bill of material will be attached based on the quantity and stuff. The bill of material will suggest the quantities, and according to the suggested quantities, they will issue the material in the system. So the raw material will be transferred to the manufacturing unit. From your raw material warehouse, it will pick the raw materials and it will transfer to the manufacturing unit. So when it is dumped into the manufacturing unit, it will process it, mix it up, everything, and then the output start coming. So the when the bags, this 1,000 bags are coming out, so then controlling this 1,000 bags will be much difficult. So what they will do, they will give a lot, like for example 100 bags. Okay, so what will happen, this batch will have 10 lots, right? Now Serial number. Serial number is unique for each one bank. Serial number is unique for one bank. Now, again, there is no hard and fast rule. Suppose if it is a medicine scenario, so if you have one leaf of the tablets, like if you say the popular one is Calpol, Alkerosin or Brufin, so this one tablet, it will have 10 or 15 tablets and it will carry only one serial number. Okay, so it depends. So it's not much like it will be, it's a kind of unique identifier. Now, why this controlling is required? Okay, the example for this controls, just to make sure, just please confirm my voice and screen is fine.
Farhan, it is fine.
Yeah, thank you. Otherwise, I'll keep talking all the night and there is one. Fine. So why this one is required? Why this type of controlling is required? This is for safety. Safety reason. The main purpose is the safety. What is the meaning of safety? There are a lot of things, the manufacturing things, which where it is good or bad will only identify it after it's after we use it. Okay, or the testing result comes on a very later stage. Okay, I'll give you example. Example like say for example concrete mix or your block manufacturing. What is the block manufacturing? Block manufacturing is like your you know, when you make the big buildings, they will give you the blocks. The big blocks, the brick is different and the block is different. So block is made up of cement and some materials and stuff. Brick is the red color, brick is different. So now I'm talking about the block. So block manufacturing, what happens when you are doing the block manufacturing in one day, there will be around any, it's a huge number of huge number will be manufactured. Like in Dubai, when the construction was on peak, the requirement for the blocks per day is like uncountable. I mean, a lot of blocks manufacturing was required. So like in India, traditionally how we do, we put it in the, we mix the raw material, keep it in the boxes, and we keep it for drying in the sun for a longer time. Then we use some, sometime we use the fire to, you know, to mature these blocks and all. So in India we use that mechanism, but in UAE and these advanced countries, what they do, they have a room for you know, room for manufacturing. It's like a pizza. You know, you keep a bread and you put the cheese and stuff and you put it in the machine, and after 10 minutes it will come out like a cooked pizza. Same way, what they do, they put the blocks in one room. And that block is going inside the room, and with the various room temperature, heaters and fires and everything, it is going through the things and it will come out within 10-15 minutes, the block will be coming out. Okay. Now the block will come out and they start sending it to the construction site. What they do now, when they complete this batch, they will take the sample, send to testing department. Okay, from this batch they will send one sample, two bricks or five bricks or 10 bricks, they will send the sample to the testing department. So this testing department, the testing they cannot do just like that. For testing, what they have to do, they have to put it in a pressure machine. That pressure machine will keep applying the force on this block, and they will keep it for 10 hours, 15 hours, 20 hours, like that, or 2 days, 3 days, whatever the force power required. So the block should retain. Otherwise, if the block broke, that means that that batch is not good. So if one block out of say 100 blocks, if one block is broken, that means that 100, because it came out in the same same lot and the same batch, then it is not good. So that complete batch need to be called back to the manufacturing unit, right? Reason being, if they don't call it back, then maybe the building collapses. If building collapses, many people will die, right? So they have to call them back. So what they do, they agree with the construction companies, like if some batch failed or if we need to revert back that material, you have to send it back to us. And the loss you face in this one, the manufacturer will pay for this one. Or sometimes they mutually agreed for the loss, what should happen in this scenario. So many times what will happen, they will send the concrete, they will send the the plaster and the blocks, everything. They build the building and the work is going on. And after 10-15 days, they will be informed like this blocks is failed. So this wall need to be broke, or these rooms need to be broke, or this building totally need to be demolished and reconstruct. If it is a plaster, if it is concrete, if you see the concrete mix, okay, let's continue with this one. So that block need to be called back. Now they deliver it, now this 1000 blocks, maybe they send 200 in one location, 200 in one location. Okay, 500 in another location, like that. They have sent it in the different to the different customers, to the different construction site. They delivered this material. Fine. So now, sitting in the manufacturing unit, when they come back to you and say this is gone, this block is broken, and the quality is very bad, and we cannot use it. You need to call this material back. But the people sitting in your warehouse, how can he bring it back? Unless he know where this lot is gone, where this where this batch is delivered, he will not be able to identify out of my 500 customers to whom I deliver this material, and from where I should be getting it back. Okay, so that is the reason. So that is the reason that this batch controls, lot controls, serial controls are required. This is one of the example. Another example is medicine. Medicine, suppose if some serial number, if somebody reported like after eating this material we had a reaction, or somebody died after consuming this medicine immediately, so then the manufacturer of the medicines, he need to call back all the medicines he sell from this lot and this serial number, right? So he must record whenever he is selling, whenever he is doing the shipping and this thing, he must record this information, where this information is going, where these materials are going. And if some complaints come in, so from one customer, if one location, if we say it is broken or something happened, or from the testing unit, if it is informed that it is broken, so he has to call from all the different locations. So unless we have a batch number, lot number, serial number controlled with these material movements, we'll not be able to track them. Okay, so this is some query on the quantity control part. So this is what we discuss on the quantity part. All these items, again, when we go to the system, we go on the screen. So I will quickly move across the navigations and the definitions, because the theory I'm explaining you pre-hand. Like for example, if I take you to organization. What was the words? So in this inventory definition, here we have the revision and the lot control and the system. Okay, lot control, serial control. So I'm explaining you all this beforehand because on the screens we'll be bored. Okay, after we have the full theory, then when you come to the step, we'll just click yes, yes, no, no, we'll move forward. Right? Now, tracking wise, I have told you all the theory. Now the cost. Costing methods. Now these are the four basic costings. We have standard costing, average costing, FIFO and LIFO, right? So the 99% will be using average costing. All my experience, I haven't seen anybody use the standard cost or FIFO or LIFO. Okay, it will go for with the average cost. Why it is so? Standard cost is required where you need to track the variances. If you have a material today and you are using it continuously, so what we do for the standard cost, we first keep the cost list of cost of all the materials, and whenever we purchase it, will system will keep generating the differences, and we need to track those differences. I'm not very sure in what kind of industry is that much of tracking is required. But people mostly, they will simply average it all. So what is an average costing? Because it's mostly used, we'll discuss in very much detail. FIFO LIFO is like first in, first out, last in, last out. So when we are consuming the material, like we are doing the receiving one, receiving two, receiving three, receiving four. So first in, first out is when you are issuing the material, so the costs need to be recorded. So how the system will record the cost, it will see the way, what was the first receiving we did, what was the cost of that receiving. So it will go with that one. The first cost will go, the second cost will go, the third cost will go, the same way it will follow the sequence. Last in, first out, work in a reverse direction. So it will first take the last material cost when you're issuing, then when the quantity keep reducing, then it will take the previous one, then it will take the previous one like that. Then what is the average costing? Standard, FIFO, LIFO, average. So average cost. Average costing, what will happen in average costing, system will average out the point cost and maintain one value. What does it mean? For example, we have on-hand quantity. On-hand quantity and current cost. So it is 10 and the current cost is 25. Okay. Now, let's say for example, we are getting a new receiving we are doing. New receiving, we are receiving quantity 10 again. New quantity and the new cost. new cost is say example 30. Okay. Now when the stock come in, once you finish this delivery, now we have the quantity, the on hand already was 10, and the new quantity which came in is 10, so it is 20 now. Now 20 quantity we have it in the system. Now what is my cost? What is my cost? Cost is the average formula. What is the average formula? Is 25 plus 30 by 20. I also forgot. It is the current cost plus new cost by quantity. Divided by. So it will be something around 25 equal to 25 plus 30. Divided by 20. Oh, sorry. 26.5. So the new cost of the item will be showing as a 26.5 because the previous one is 25 and the new cost is 30. So in average, system will not show you separate values, the cost values. So in average, what will happen? System will club it up and it will show you the one value as the average of the this value, so it will be showing you 26.5. So your quantity will be 20 and your current cost of the inventory will be showing as 26.5. Okay, so far so good. Now what type of complications may come in the costing area? The simple issues will be like first thing, costed and non-costed, where we discuss the material if it is given by customer for packing purpose. So that one it has to go with a zero cost. So what will happen is like if you have this packing material and they also give you the packing material. You have a packing material item code say PK001 and your customer also give you the same material and it is also PK001. Now what? Because here it has a cost because it's your inventory, so it is carrying a cost of 50. But this material is not your material and it's carrying a cost of 0. Okay, so when you bring these two in, when you keep both of them in the same item cost, system don't know it is yours and it is customers. So every time you get in the zero cost material here, it will keep reducing the cost of the your material, which is not correct. So companies will not accept. They will say, how come? It has to be separately maintained because it's a customer material and it is not impacting my inventory. So this zero should not impact my cost. Okay, so then what to do? So if you keep the same item code, so system will simply sum it up and try to generate one average cost, and which will definitely keep reducing this because this one is always coming with zero value, right? So this is like one simple complication. You need to find a solution. Now the simple solution people will suggest, okay, you maintain a different item code for this one, you give it a code as 2. So this is like basic thing we can think of. Now, if you give a packing code of, item code of 02, what will happen? The quantities will be showing differently. If you need to see the total quantity, then you have to club two different item codes to see the quantity. Okay, so such, interesting things will come. So you can think of. So that is what the one simple complication. And the another thing, with the manufacturing inventory, so manufacturing inventory, this there is this one cannot be used. This type of average costing, all these four costing methods will not be helpful for the manufacturing costing. So manufacturing costing will work with There is a concept called period moving average cost. Yeah, PMAG, period moving average cost. So they need this period moving average cost. So I'll just give you the name. You can search if sometime you get the manufacturing project, you can study this one. Very interesting concept on that one. Okay, so this is about the basics. So what we discuss, inventory. So inventory will have, we have to track the quantity, we have to track the cost. So quantity wise tracking, we discuss like we'll have the different sub inventories, we'll have different locations. So we can have different inventory outs, different sub inventories, different rows, racks and location bin combination. So with the help of this, we can track the, you know, we can track the locations and all. And this is for the control purpose, the batch lots and the serial numbers. So again, there is no hard and fast rule. This will call inventory, this will call sub inventory. No, many times we have to get inventories and sub inventories which are virtual, right? One example, one more example, if I can give you for the virtual one. So example is like for the oil manufacturing. So the raw oil will be coming in, and that raw oil will be processed, and then it will be, then you will, okay, you need to draw something. Virtual inventory. So how do you call virtual inventory? What is the concept of the virtual? So it's that kind of oil. Okay. So that oil manufacturing, what you have is around here. And this raw material, now this manufacturing you do for our company, and you also do it for government, okay, kind of subsidized. So you also do it for the government. Now you have one container for the this raw material, they call it silos. You have one silo to, and it is a very big, very huge one to store this you know, raw material. Right now you cannot have this one multiple, the price is, it's very costly, and it is it will be one only. Okay, so all the raw material will be coming into the, you know, the unprocessed oil will be coming into this one, and from here it will go into the different lines, process one by one, process one by one, and final product will come. Okay, so when the final product is coming, the scenario is like, the scenario, the government said, okay, we'll give you the raw material, so you don't charge us for the raw material, because it's the government, they will give it for a cheaper prices. So they said like, we'll give you raw material, you don't need to buy raw material for us. Okay, you just process it and give us the final product, and we'll give you processing fee. Okay, so when the final product come out, so you will have our finished goods, government finished goods. Now this is fine because it's our raw material, our finished goods, we can calculate the cost and everything, this goes fine. Now this one, what they say, we'll give you the raw material, if you are charging them for the finished goods, we'll charge them fully for the raw material, for processing fee, and finally we'll tell them this is the cost you have to pay. But they said, okay, we'll give you the raw material, you just process it, and for the processing you charge 5% or 2% or something, you can take the processing fee from us. Right now the raw material is coming and is going here. So here you have oil which belongs to you, And inside this one, you got a raw material given by ministry. So you have the raw material here. And both of them is same oil, same crude oil. Okay. So once you put both of them inside, it's mixed. Okay. Now, how will you identify which one belongs to whom? Can we do that one? We cannot do that, right? So we have to put the assumption like there is a separate sub-inventory inside this warehouse, and this sub-inventory quantity belongs to government, this sub-inventory quantity belongs to our company, right? But physically, if you go and see, it's a mixed, it's totally mixed. So inside this one, maybe some customer also bring their own raw material, and they will say we'll also give the raw material. So some customer raw material might be there. So there is no physical appearance of this. So that's why we can have a physical warehouses, but sub-inventories and structure, but we also require to think of the virtual warehouses and virtual inventories. Okay. So this is good enough, I think. And fine. So today we'll stop with the theory. Okay. So next class, we'll go into the system. And we'll define this inventory, sub-inventory, and all these structures. And then we'll see how it look like, and we'll move to the transactions. Okay. So, any questions in this one? I'll close it for the day. No questions.
Hi Paran, I don't have any question at the moment, but just want to know the duration for this entire session. How much or how many days they need to complete this session?
You mean the complete course?
Yeah, or you can give us idea about P2P will take like 15 days or 20 days, and 15 days for O2C kind of. If you have any idea, that's fine.
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't calculate because sometimes
okay.
If I go with the flow, so most probably what I'm targeting is like next week. Now inventory, I have to speak all the theory mostly. So we just need to go on the form and say this is this, this is this. So we'll just click and move. Anything new we see, we can discuss theory. And then we have the purchasing. So hopefully the configurations will finish by next week. For P2P, configuration
okay.
I will by 31st of August, which means purchasing module setup, inventory module, AP module, and GL module setup, I'll finish by 31st. Okay. Then the following week we'll do the transactions, full transactions from purchasing to general ledger. Obviously, we'll include right from your budget creation, then requisition creation, and then purchasing, then seeing the impact on the budgets. When you do requisition, what's happening to budget? When you create PO, what's happening to budget? Then approvals, and then inventory receiving, invoicing. So all full cycle. We'll see, or maybe that full cycle will take a week. Okay. Because I'm just trying to maximize the session. So otherwise, we can also give you full training in 5 days. It depends. The next week we'll finish inventory and purchasing configurations. So the following week we'll discuss the transactions from start to end, and then the another following week we'll do order management and AR. Yeah, so because there will be only two modules left in order to cash, so in 1 week it should finish. So most probably 3 weeks from now.
Okay. Okay. That's fine. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so I'll close it for today. And next, I think tomorrow we don't have class, and Friday we don't have it. Saturday, so Monday is the next class. Okay, so see you guys on Monday. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good weekend. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Farhan.